I really have a thing for diabetes now. I have to deal with so much with that that I'm particularly enjoying the talking about it. So the question had come in, and the reason I think this question came in is because I think it's in our it was in the Beck Buck, excuse me, Buck textbook, and it's in the AAPC textbook that we use now as well. So what is the proper code? Oh, did that say E code? For a diabetic with ketoacidosis due to malfunction of insulin pump, pump failed to deliver insulin causing ketoacidosis. So I did a whole
Answer.
bunch of research, but she said E code and I didn't put in an E code. I'll have to think about it. I can probably come up with it from memory. So diabetes with ketoacidosis due to failure of insulin pump. Now, what you have to think about when you're doing something where when you're coding for something when you have when you're coding and something goes wrong, think complication. The terminology that you're going to use to look up the codes is complication. There's a whole great big section in the index under complication. So when you look under complication and then you look up insulin, and then it'll say insulin pump, you're going to find 99657 in medical complication due to insulin pump. Select this code to report the mechanical failure of an insulin pump, a device used by diabetics that injects insulin into the bloodstream in intervals to regulate blood sugar levels. So if you're familiar with a diabetic sliding scale, if you've heard that term before, and what that is, you know, if you're looking at a prescription for insulin, it'll usually say, you know, maybe 10 cc's, you know, at 10 cc's in, let me think, they take it in the afternoon and the evening, but every morning they take 5 cc's, and that's because the insulin, you want more insulin as you're more active, and when you wake up in the middle, you know, when you wake up in the morning, you haven't been active, so you don't need as much insulin. But let's say a person has all kinds of things going on with their blood sugar, so their insulin goes up and down, and they use a sliding scale. So they check their sugar before they eat their lunch, and if it's, you know, 175 to 200, they use X amount of insulin. If it's 200 to 250, they use X amount of insulin. And they have this like 10-point little grid, you'd say, of how much insulin to go per what their blood sugar is. Now, this is really obnoxious to do for some insulin users because they're constantly having to check their blood sugar. And you may have to do that like 10 times a day. But what the insulin pump does is it actually checks your blood sugar for you. You stick it in your side. It's got a little thing that looks like a cell phone, you know, or a music thing, and you don't even hardly know it's there, and it actually delivers the insulin as it's supposed to, as you need it per your blood sugar. But if that goes wrong, gets clogged, stops working, you are in big trouble, and you usually don't know it. So you can go into ketoacidosis. So what is ketoacidosis? 250.10 is the code for diabetes with ketoacidosis, meaning that ketoacidosis is something that you have constantly, like a manifestation, but this is a manifestation. This means you're in bad shape. So type 2 are unspecified, not stated as uncontrolled, all the things that are associated with. Now, they throw in that you can use V58.67 because that's long-term insulin use, so you usually get to code that as well. So what is ketoacidosis? It's a really bad thing for diabetics. It's going to cause all kinds of problems. And what it means is it produces high levels of blood acids called ketones in the body. The diabetic ketoacidosis, excuse me, develops when your body is unable to produce enough insulin. Thus, you would be taking insulin, right? If your pump's not working and you don't know it, you don't check your sugar. The insulin normally plays a key role, up too far, let's see, plays a key role in helping regulate your sugar, your glucose, a major source of energy for your muscles and other tissues. Enter your cells. Without enough insulin, your body begins to break down fat at an alternate as an alternate fuel. So in other words, it's literally going to start feeding off of fat to produce enough insulin for your body to survive, which is not a good thing because that's not what the fat was intended to do. And as a result, it's going to make a buildup of toxic acids in the bloodstream. It would be like saying, okay, we're going to have a fire in our fireplace. We don't have firewood, so we're going to start burning all this paper that is magazines and stuff in it, or something that had creosote on it or something. And so you're literally burning a toxin instead of what you're supposed to be burning. So scroll down just a little bit here, and I can tell you that, okay, that's ketones. And when that builds up to a toxic level, that's ketoacidosis. Not a good thing. And what it does is it just exacerbates the signs of diabetes, usually high blood sugar. You know, when your blood sugar goes up, you get confused, you start going to the, you urinate more frequently, you're very thirsty, you can sometimes literally fall asleep. A sign, one sign is, they used to teach us as EMTs, and they teach police officers too, you look like you're drunk. And so, you know, if they pull somebody over and they think they're drunk, and one of the things they tell you to do is you get up in their face and you can smell their breath, and their breath is very sweet and almost almondy smelling, you know, like the nuts, almonds, and then you know, hey, something's not right, and this guy could be diabetic, not drunk.
Are you telling people how to get out of a DUI?
No. They can make you prove it. But so if you scroll down, it'll tell you some of those signs. This can happen so quickly. Now, another thing that happens is when the people will slip into diabetic ketoacidosis if they're sick. So let's say, especially like you have a child that's a diabetic, and they catch the flu, or they have an ear infection, or even an adult gets a UTI and they don't know it and they're diabetic. This happens a lot with the older population that are diabetic, and your body goes out of whack. You go into ketoacidosis because you your insulin's off. Those are really all the classic signs of diabetes. That fruity scented breath, which also we used to say almondy. So let's see. Actually, you take they do a blood test or a urine test, and if your blood sugar is high, and I'm talking really high. This ketoacidosis, people get into like 500s and stuff, which is just not good. And not only does it absolutely eat the fat, it eats away at your good organs too. This compromises all of your organs. So, you know, you got things happening right and left. You don't want to go into ketoacidosis. Now, the reason that you code it this way and you code the complication code first, it's the reason why the person went into ketoacidosis. That's why it goes first. And you need to make sure, because they track it. We forget that we're not just doing this for reimbursement. We're also doing it for statistical purposes. So if they go in and all of a sudden you've got all of these people that are having diabetic ketoacidosis problems, and they use that complication code, it's because of the pump, then you betcha they're going to go and figure out what's wrong with that pump. What brand are they using? You know, is there something, is it because they had an ear infection or a UTI? You know, what do we need to do to make the pumps better? What do we need to do to make diabetics more aware so that we don't have this problem? And so always keep that in mind while you're coding. This isn't all about reimbursement. A lot of what you do is about statistical purposes, and it changes the future of the healthcare by coding properly.
Get more CPC exam tips, coding certification training, and CEU credits. Go to www.codingcertification.org.